الحمد لله الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده وبعد. الحمد لله. We should be on page now 259 of our Mus'haf, which we're running from ayah 25 We had completed the discussion where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes the likeness of the good tree. Now we're moving forward from that point. Now Imam Ibn Jawzi, rahimahullah, he starts by saying, quote, as for the likeness of the good tree, it has indeed been compared with the human being in his iman, because every tree, if it's cut from its root, which symbolizes the head of the man, then the rest of it comes down with it. Because a tree without a root or a trunk cannot bear itself. Allah the Exalted says further to this matter, تُؤْتِي أُكُلَهَا كُلَّ حِينٍ بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهَا وَيَضْرِبُ اللَّهُ الْأَمْثَالَ لِلنَّاسِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ وَمَثَلُ كَلِمَةٍ خَبِيثَةٍ كَشَجَرَةٍ خَبِيثَةٍ اشْتُطَّتْ مِنْ فَوْقِ الْأَرْضِ مَا لَهَا مِنْ قَرَارٍ يثبت الله الذين آمنوا بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة ويضل الله الظالمين ويفعل الله ما يشاء ألم تر إلى الذين بدلوا نعمة الله كفرا وأحلوا قومهم دار البوار جهنم يصلونها وبئس القرار وجعلوا لله أندادا ليضلوا عن سبيله قل تمتعوا فإن مصيركم إلى النار قل لعبادي الذين آمنوا يقيموا الصلاة وينفقوا مما رزقناهم سرا وعلانية من قبل أن يأتي يوم لا بيع فيه ولا خلال الله الذي خلق السماوات والأرض وأنزل من السماء ماء فأخرج به من الثمرات رزقا لكم وسخر لكم الفلك لتجري في البحر بأمره وسخر لكم الأنهار وسخر لكم الشمس والقمر دائبين وسخر لكم الليل والنهار. And so it is given its food at every time by the permission of its Lord. And similarly, Allah gives further examples to people so that they might reflect and remember. The likeness of the filthy tree is like a filthy tree that grows up from over the earth, but it has no firmly established roots or trunk. Allah establishes those who believe with the trustworthy statement in the earthly life and in the hereafter. He leads astray, Allah leads astray those who are the oppressors. He, Allah, does what He wills. Have you not seen those who replace the favor of Allah with unbelief, and their people laid themselves bare to receive the punishment, and the great fire shall scorch them, and what an evil eternal return. They have made for Allah rivals that lead them astray from the path. Say, you will be sufficed, but indeed your end result and trial is toward the fire. Say to my slaves who believe and establish the prayer and spend of that which we have sustained them with in secret and openly from before, that there comes to them a day in which there shall be no trade in it, nor shall there be any friendship or brotherhood. Allah is the one who created the skies and earth and sent from the sky water, and he brought forth by means of it from the vegetation as a sustenance for you. He has subjugated for you the boats and means of transportation in the water so that you might move in the ocean by his command. And he has subjugated for you the rivers and bodies of water. He has subjugated for you the sky. He has subjugated for you the sun and the moon, moving about da'ibain, moving about in predetermined orders. And he has subjugated for you the night and the day. Surah Ibrahim, the 15th Surah, ayat 25 to 33. The Exalted One, when he has discussed the filthy tree, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu has said that the filthy tree symbolizes major shirk. And the likeness of the filthy tree that Allah the Exalted gave carries five statements regarding it. The first thing about the filthy tree is that the filthy tree represents the colocynth, which gives off a strong scent. This was narrated by Anas ibn Malik from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who stated this in a hadith as collected by Tabarani. And likewise, it is the ruling of Anas ibn Malik himself, as well as Mujahid, the student of Ibn Abbas. The second is that it is referring to the unbeliever. The filthy tree is talking about the unbeliever who is committing shirk, as mentioned by Ibn Abi Talha in a narration from Ibn Abbas. Ibn Abbas also mentioned at another point that the unbeliever, his deeds are not accepted. They do not ascend up to Allah. So he has nothing in the earth firmly established for him, and nothing moves towards the sky. So the earth that would be a trunk for the root of the tree of Iman, he has nothing of it, nor the fruits of that which would spread towards the sky. He has no such thing. The third thing that this is referring to is that it is also a weed. It's a weed because the weed has no true roots, but merely scavenges off of those plants around it. This is mentioned by Al-Dahhak from Ibn Abbas. The fourth statement is that it is referring not to a literal tree, as we can see from the ayah, but instead it's a metaphor. And the filthy tree is a metaphor for something. And this is also discussed by Ibn Abbas. And the fifth statement, Ibn Abbas has said as well, though, that a type of filthy tree is the garlic tree. For this tree emits a strong stench. Now, when the Exalted One mentions the filthy tree that grows up above the earth with no roots, Ibn Qutaybah has said that, so it's ready to be cut down, for it has no roots. As Zajjaj has said, whenever something like that is unrooted, according to the Arabic language, it means that it has no firm base. And then the Exalted One says that it has no firm establishment. No firm establishment is referring to the fact that there's no trunk, there's no base to it, in which it can connect itself to the earth. And furthermore, because it cannot connect itself to the earth, it cannot be established. And so the likeness that's being given to the unbeliever with this tree is that the unbeliever, his righteous deeds that he might do, never ascend up. Neither does any good word that he says. And so he has no word for him that's firmly established. And when Allah says that he establishes those who believe, meaning he establishes them upon the truth with the well-established word. That well-established word is the testimony of La ilaha illallah, there is no God but Allah. He establishes them upon this in this earthly life and in the hereafter. So the earthly life is firstly talking about the life that one has on the face of the earth. And the hereafter is talking about from the time one is put in their grave until the end. And this has been mentioned in commentary by Al-Bara ibn Azib, as well as some ahadith in al-Tabarani, in al-Tabari. Secondly, I want to mention that the earthly life, when Allah says that he will establish those who believe with a clear statement, the clear word in the earthly life is also talking about the life that he has in the grave. Because that is the consequence of his earthly life. And the hereafter is the reckoning on the day of resurrection. Now this was mentioned by Tawus and Qatada. All the scholars of commentary, they say, this ayah is one of those narrated about the punishment of the grave and the questioning of the angels. It is also in reference to Allah firmly establishing the believers with the word of truth at the time of their being questioned. And only He, Allah alone, can establish someone upon the truth at that time. And He, Allah, leads astray the oppressors, meaning the idol worshippers. He, Allah, leads them astray from this word. And He, Allah, does what He wills, meaning that He provides guidance for the believer and astrayness for the unbeliever. So He does what He wills. And these are the realities. Close quote. Now, very quickly, this brings up something. Some people may not have seen this before. Some people may have. It is known as talqin. 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 Talqin is where you'll have someone visit the ill or dying person with the words of La ilaha illallah, and you'll give them these words, you'll enjoin them to say them before they die. Everyone knows about that. But talqin is also when, after the dead person has died, you go to their grave saying the words of La ilaha illallah to remind them that that's the only thing that can establish them in the sight of Allah, that's the only thing that can protect them. Right? This is called talqin. So you visit them when they're ill, and you visit them after they die with the words of La ilaha illallah to remind them that that's the only thing that establishes them. Talqin. It's called talqin. This is especially well known in Sham. He's mentioning it because he has a preference for it. Some scholars say that the references to talqin in terms of ahadith are not that strong. Ibn al-Jawzi, you can tell that he advocates the position of talqin, and he's using this ayah. Now, the hadith that goes with this ayah is in Bukhari. And so that is unimpeachable, because that's clearly talqin after someone has died. That's called talqin. You can't deny that. Some people have thought originally, especially in the English-speaking world, that, oh, that's just a Shami thing. But it's not a Shami thing, because Ibn al-Jawzi is Iraqi. He's from Iraq. So it can't just be a Shami thing. It's something that's from Iraq. And it's a difference of opinion. If someone doesn't do talqin when they go to the grave and they're willing to talqin before they die, that's okay. If someone does, then they can't be denied that, because they can. The individual that is in favor of talqin can quote an ayah, and they can quote the hadith in Bukhari that goes with this ayah. Very quickly, something else as well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His Majesty, because the word that He uses for this earthly life in the next ayah is Dar al-Bawar. Okay, that's in ayah 28. Dar al-Bawar. Bawar means like hardships and difficulties. And that's one of the words that Allah used for this earthly life. Dar al-Bawar. Right? But in the hereafter, Allah uses the word al-Qarar, which is an ayah right after. Al-Qarar means when something is firmly established. Right? It is something that is permanently established. So the hereafter, Allah refers to it as Al-Qarar or Dar al-Qarar. And the earthly life He refers to as Dar al-Bawar. So this is another example. If you're ever looking at a warning where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that I will certainly punish these people with fire, and you're saying, okay, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that He's going to permanently punish those people with fire, or is that going to be a temporary punishment? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ends an ayah by saying azabun muqim, right, it's a punishment in which is firmly established. Or He says khalidina fiha, forever therein, khalidina fiha abada, right? If He says, makes statements like that, it's permanent. But if He makes a statement at the end of an ayah regarding punishment and says that this is for them Dar al-Bawar, and the Dar al-Bawar are similar euphemistic statements, that means that the punishment is for a period of time, they'll come out. But if He says that they'll receive the punishment in Dar al-Qarar, and they'll never recover, they'll never come out, ma kharijina minha, right, they'll never come out, that's permanent, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes these statements. Now Imam al-Jawzi rahimahullah, he then says, quote, the Exalted One, when He says, have you not seen those who, they have replaced the favor of Allah with kufr. Now, this is referring to some 7 incidents. The first of which is that those who have replaced the favor of Allah are the following rebellious groups from the Quraysh. They are the Bani Umayyah and the Bani Al-Mughirah. This was mentioned by Umar ibn al-Khattab and Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhumah Now, after mentioning that it's referring to the Bani Umayyah and the Bani Al-Mughira, the second point is that it's also referring to the hypocrites that have come from the Quraysh. This is collected by Abu Tufayl from Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. The third point is that it is discussing, as we mentioned, the Bani Umayyah and the Bani Al-Mughira, but it's also talking about the leaders that came to Badr in order to help the unbelieving troops. And this was mentioned by Ibn Abbas. The next is that, number four, is that it's referring to the unbelievers of Mecca. This statement was narrated by Ibn Abbas and Al-Dhahhak, or the other wine woman. Number five is that it is referring to the idol worshippers from the people of Badr. This was said by Mujahid and Ibn Zayd. Number six, those who were killed in the Battle of Badr from the ranks of the unbelievers of Quraysh. These are the sixth category. This was mentioned by Sa'id ibn Jubayr and Abu Malik. But I also want to say that, seventhly, this ayah can also be applied generally to all idol worshippers who reject the true faith. And this is said by Al-Hasan al-Basri as well. The scholars of commentary have also mentioned that the replacement of the favor of Allah with kufr is that Allah favored them with his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had he had them live among him. He also allowed the unbelievers to stay in his haram sanctuary, yet they rejected faith in Allah and his messenger after that. So Allah therefore abandoned that people to the kufr that they were in. And that means that Allah abandoned them in Dar al-Balar. He abandoned them in this earthly life to destruction. And then he explained that they would then be at the great fire that would scorch them. And then in the hereafter, they would have the great tribulation of the Al-Qarar. Allah then says that they made for Allah rivals, Andad. We've already discussed the issue of Andad in Surah Al-Baqarah, the second surah, ayah 22. So there is no need to go over this here. As for the lamb and the expression, liyudillu, so that they might lead them astray. This particular lamb that is used so that they might is one for judgment. Allah sometimes uses this particular expression to judge and as a recompense for their wickedness. But we've already discussed this in Surah Yunus, the 10th Surah, ayah 88. Now, whoever should read the statement as la yadillu or liyudillu, both of these narrations are sound. But the second of these means that so they might lead the people astray from the faith of, and deen of Allah. And when Allah says to say to them, take your provisions in the earthly life, this is actually a threat that Allah is giving them. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu has said, if the unbeliever is ill and didn't sleep or was hungry and didn't eat or drink, that would have been better for him to give him a taste of the punishment that's coming. And if the believer had given up and looked at the favors of this earthly life, once he saw the favors of the hereafter, he would have felt great sadness at having ever been content with the earthly life. For the hereafter is much better. And the Exalted One, when he says, say to my slaves who believe. Now, this particular recitation, Ibn Amr, Hamza, Al-Kasai have made the ya silent, in which they've said, قُلْ لِعِبَاد or قُلْ لِعِبَادِ, whereas the others have said, قُلْ لِعِبَادِيَ. So say to my slaves who they believe that they establish the prayer. Ibn Al-Ambari has said, this means, say to my slaves, establish the prayer and spend of that which they've been given. So they establish the prayer, they give the zakah, and what Allah has commanded them. And so it's possible that this is also referring to the fact that they're being told as the slaves of Allah to establish the prayer, to spend in the goodness before the time comes where they will not be able to. So tell them to establish the prayer, to give the zakah, to not be negligent in these matters. And ask for the statement before a time comes where there shall be no trading or no friendship. This has already been discussed in Surah Al-Baqarah, the second surah, ayah 254, where this has been treated in a similar ayah. The Exalted One says, we have also, there's been subjugated for you the rivers and bodies of water. This means that they have been subjugated for you so that you might move upon them whenever you will. That you ride on modes of transportation upon these waters whenever you so desire. He, Allah, says he subjugated for you the sun and the moon, meaning so that you might take benefit from them and use the light that comes from them, and that they move about in a system so that what comes from them rectifies the plants and other things, and that they don't die off, because it's required the light from the first source for the plants to survive. And so he, Allah, is speaking to the people in a way in which they will be able to understand. Close quote. Very quick. You will notice, as I mentioned this before, Imam Al-Jawzi rahimahullah lived close to 1,000 years ago. You will notice he is discussing something that we now call photosynthesis, 1,000 years before it came out. You might want to make a note of that, because we have to remember this was a long time ago. Now, the Imam rahimahullah, he then says, quote, and Allah says that he subjugated for you the night and the day. He subjugated the night so that you might be still in it and rest your bodies. And he subjugated the day so that you might take benefit from it and seek your livelihood. And these are the realities. Because he, Allah, has given you the day so that you might seek your livelihood. Then after this, Allah the Exalted, he says,
وَآتَاكُمْ مِنْ كُلِّ مَا سَأَلْتُمُوهُ وَإِنْ تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَظَلُومٌ كَفَّارٌ وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ اجْعَلْ هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا وَجَنُبَنِي وَبَنِيَّ أَنْ نَعْبُدَ الْأَصْنَامِ رَبِّ إِنَّهُنَّ أَضْلَلْنَ كَثِيرًا مِنَ النَّاسِ فَمَنْ تَبِعَنِي فَإِنَّهُ مِنِّي وَمَنْ عَصَانِي فَإِنَّكَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ رَبَّنَا إِنِّي أَسْكَنْتُ مِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي بِوَادٍ غَيْرِ ذِي زَرْعٍ عِنْدَ بَيْتِكَ الْمُحَرَّمِ رَبَّنَا لِيُقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ فَاجْعَلْ أَفْئِدَةً مِنَ النَّاسِ تَهْوِي إِلَيْهِمْ وَارْزُقَهُمْ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَشْكُرُونَ رَبَّنَا إِنَّكَ تَعْلَمُ مَا نُخْفِي وَمَا نُعْلِنُ وَمَا يَخْفَى عَلَى اللَّهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي السَّمَاءِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي وَهَبَ لِي عَلَى الْكِبَرِ إِسْمَاعِيلَ وَإِسْحَاقَ إِنَّ رَبِّي لَسَمِيعُ الدُّعَاءِ رَبِّ اجْعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِن ذُرِّيَّتِي رَبَّنَا وَتَقَبَّلْ دُعَاءِ رَبَّنَا وَتَقَبَّلْ دُعَاءِ رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الْحِسَابُ وَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ اللَّهَ غَافِلًا عَمَّا يَعْمَلُ الظَّالِمُونَ إِنَّمَا يُؤَخِّرُهُمْ لِيَوْمٍ تَشْخَصُ فِيهِ الْأَبْصَارُ. And so he gave them all of that which they asked him. If you were to count the favors of Allah, you could not accurately count them all. Indeed, the human being is oppressive and ungrateful. When Ibrahim said, Lord, make this land safe and keep me and my progeny, keep me and my children from worshipping idols. Lord, indeed, they shall lead astray many from humanity. Whoever follows me, then he is from me. Whoever disobeys me, then you are forgiving and merciful. Lord, indeed, I've been made to live, and let my progeny come from me to a valley that has very little vegetation in front of your sacred house. Lord, let the prayer be established, and make the people have affection towards it. Sustain them from the sustenance so that they might be thankful to you. Lord, indeed you know what we conceal and what we manifest. And nothing is hidden from Allah in the earth nor in the sky. Praise be to Allah, the one who bestowed on me in my old age Ismail and Ishaq. Indeed, my Lord, he hears the supplication. Lord, make me a place of prayer in front of the people and from my progeny the same. Lord, accept this supplication. Lord, forgive me and my parents from before and the believers on the day in which the reckoning shall be established. And do not believe that Allah is unmindful regarding what the oppressors do. Indeed, he delays them until a day in which the eyes will roll back in the head in abject terror. Surah Ibrahim, 15th Surah, Ayat 34 to 42. The Exalted One, when he has said that he gives them all of what they ask for, there are five things that this is referring to. The first is that he, Allah, gives them of all of that which they ask for, something of it. Meaning not all of it, but he gives them some of what they ask for. This is mentioned by Al-Hasan al-Basri and Ikrimah ibn Abi Jahl. Secondly, it's referring to the fact that of all of that which they ask him, he gives them, if they will actually ask him. This is mentioned by Al-Fawwah. Number three is that he gives you a portion of everything that you ask. So the pronoun here of all or everything refers back to the thing, meaning not everything, but a portion of everything. An example of this is where Allah said, وَأُوْتِيَتْ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ, and they were given a portion of everything. Surah An-Naml, the 28th Surah, Ayah 23. So, meaning everything that is there, you're given a portion of it in its time. And this was said by Al-Akhfash. Likewise, Allah the Exalted, in point number four, says, of all of what you have asked him for and what you don't ask him for, you must never ask the sun, the moon, or anything else from the benefits of what he gives you. For he can provide them only. Just as he says, سَرَابِيلَ تَقِيكُمُ الْحَرُّ, shading yourselves from the heat. Surah An-Nahl, the 16th Surah, 81. So even this is a favor, as mentioned by Ibn al-Hanbali. There is also the point you need to keep in mind for number five, that according to the recitation of Ibn Mas'ud, Ibn Rizin, Al-Hasan, Ikrimah, Qatada, and Abban from Asim, and Abi Hatim and from Yaqub, it is Min Kulli Ma, in which the expression Min Kulli Ma can be recited. But the rest of the reciters say Min Kulli, but these reciters aforementioned say Min Kulli Ma. So Allah has given you a portion of all of that which you've asked for, as said by Fatada and Abdahak. And when he says, and if you were to enumerate or count the favors of Allah, you would not be able to. Meaning, you would not be able to even bring to mind all of the favors that Allah has given you due to the plethorous nature of them. Indeed, the human being is oppressive to himself and ungrateful. Ibn Abbas said, this ayah is in particular addressing Abu Jahl. But as Zajjaj has said that, it is speaking of the human race in a general sense. But the kafir out of the human race is who's being addressed. And so the one who is volum here is the one who is not thankful to the favors given to him. And the ungrateful one, the kafal, is the one who rejects the favors of Allah that he's been given. We then have the dua of Nabiyuna Ibrahim alayhi salam, in which he said, Lord, this is, make this a safe land. Now we have already in great depth discussed this dua of Ibrahim. One can see our commentary on Surah Al-Baqarah, the second surah, 126, for further details. When the Exalted One says that Nabiyuna Ibrahim alayhi salam says, and keep away from me and my children, meaning myself and them, the idolatry, he is referring to himself and his immediate children. Close quote. Now, this is a very important point. Nabiyullah Ibrahim alayhi salam, he said, keep the idol worshiper away from me and my children. The word used is baniya, because the question that might immediately come to your mind is, wait a minute. How can that be then that the Arabs committed idolatry for 1,000 years? Because the Arabs are the sons that have come through Nabiyuna Ismail alayhi salam, who is the son of Nabiyuna Ibrahim alayhi salam. So obviously Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at the end of these series of ayat, he grants the dua of Nabiyuna Ibrahim alayhi salam. What does this mean then? How can that be? He said, keep them away from it, and the Arabs, they fell into idolatry. All right. The answer to your question has to do with the word that Allah used. When he said, keep it away from me and baniya. Baniya in Arabic is one of the expressions used for banun as well, which means your immediate children. So Nabiyuna Ibrahim alayhi salam and his immediate children. That means Ismail and Ishaq, right? They're prophets. They don't commit idolatry. And the children that came from them. So you have the 12 tribes of Israel, right? The 12 sons of Nabiyuna Ismail alayhi salam. They didn't commit idolatry. They are baniya. They fall under the ruling of baniya. Allah did not promise or tell him that he would protect his dhurriya. Dhurriya are your descendants. And that's what comes after that. So the dhurriya of Nabiyuna Ibrahim alayhi salam, they did commit idolatry. And that's what you read about in later ayat. The dhurriya. So there's a difference between baniya and dhurriya. Baniya are the immediate children. Dhurriya are your descendants. Right? So the grandchildren, the great-grandchildren, and the great-great-grandchildren say that they are descendants of their ancestor, right? So they are his dhurriya. But a man and his children, those are his bani. Those are his immediate children. So this important point has to be made, because sometimes people can read the ayah and they might hear the English of it, they might read it, they're thinking, wait a minute. But the Arabs did fall into idolatry. So then how do we reconcile this? Isn't this a contradiction? No, because the word baniya and dhurriya have different senses. Imam al-Jawzi rahimahullah, he then says, quote, Lord, indeed they have led astray many of the people. Now, the expression being used is the feminine plural. And the feminine plural being referred to is discussing the idols. So, Lord, they have led many astray from the people means the idols have led many astray. And so they are the cause of this astrayness. It's not that the idols themselves did any astrayness themselves, but their presence and the people taking them led to astrayness. Then when Allah says that Nabiyullah Ibrahim alayhi salam said, whoever follows me, meaning on my deen of tawheed, then he is from me, meaning he is upon my way. And whoever disobeys me, then indeed you are forgiving and merciful. Now there are three things that need to be said about this point. Number one, whoever disobeys me, then indeed you are forgiving and merciful. This means whoever disobeys me, then he repents. You are forgiving and merciful. this was mentioned by As-Sudayi. Number two, whoever disobeys me, excluding major shirk, then you are forgiving and merciful. And this was mentioned by Muqatin ibn Hayyan. Or, number three, whoever disobeys me then rejects faith. You are forgiving and merciful if you guide him to repent and you bring him back to Tawheed. This is the statement of Muqatil ibn Sulaiman. This dua that he makes is also conditioned. Ibn al-Anbari has said that this dua was before Allah told him that he would not forgive the major shirk of those who would come after him, just as in the case of where he sought forgiveness for his father. And likewise, there is the statement when Allah the Exalted has said, Lord, indeed, I've been made to live with my descendants, meaning that he has stayed with his descendants and his descendants are near him, in a valley without much vegetation. That valley being referred to is the Bekaa Valley of Mecca. And there is hardly any vegetation nor water therein. In the sight of your sacred house, Baytik al-Muharram. It's called Muharram because it is impermissible for someone to violate its sanctity or take lightly its rights. So someone may ask the question, wait a minute, look at when Allah says in the sight of your sacred house. How could Allah be saying that when at the time that Nabiyuna Ibrahim alayhi salam was being addressed, the Kaaba had not yet been re-raised on its foundations? So why would Allah be mentioning that he's addressing him with a supplication about a place that has not been relaid on its foundations yet? The answer to this question is threefold. Number one, indeed Allah the Exalted has made the very spot where the house would sit sacred since the creation of the skies and the earth. This was mentioned by Ibn As-Sa'id. Number two, is Allah is talking about the fact that this sacred house has been rebuilt previously. So he's saying, in the sight of your sacred house, which was before raised up in the days of the flood. Number three, this ayah is referring to in the sight of your house, which from time eternity is in your knowledge, and you know that it's going to be built here. This statement was mentioned by Muhammad ibn Jarir al-Tabari. Abu Sulaiman al-Dimashqi used to say, the external speech that's been given in this ayah about the sacred house is proof, that this supplication was only made after building the sacred house and that Mecca was an established land at that time. But all of the commentators say the opposite of what Abu Sulaiman al-Dimashqi has said. Now pay attention, because it's been narrated by Ibn Abi Nujayh from Mujahid with a chain of transmission that Nabiyuna Ibrahim alayhi salam left from Sham, and he had his son Ismail alayhi salam and his mother Hajar alayhi salam with him. And also with them was the angel Jibreel alayhi salam until he came to Mecca. And at that point were some people there known as the Amalek, living outside of what was to be Mecca. And the sacred house, which was to later be rebuilt at that point, was nothing but red stones that were unhewn. Nabiyuna Ibrahim alayhi salam said to the angel Jibreel alayhi salam, is it here that I've been commanded to leave these two people? The angel Jibreel alayhi salam said, yes. So he left them in a place near where the Hijr of the Kaaba was going to be. And he commanded Hajar that she take that as a living space where they would live. Then after he made the supplication to say, my Lord, I have placed down the place where my descendants shall be, and they will live close to me. Close quote. Now, this is an important point. This is a very, very important point. Firstly, the ayah about Nabiyuna Ibrahim alayhi salam, رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الْحِسَابِ. Those that state that the prophets and their parents and their lineage, that they're all Muslims, they use this ayah. The Maturidiyya, the later Maturidiyya, the Ash'aris, use this ayah. My Lord, forgive me, my parents, the believers on the Day of Judgment. Nabiyuna Ibrahim alayhi salam couldn't be asking forgiveness for his parents if they were both mushrikeen, because we know it's impermissible to ask forgiveness for mushrikeen. So his parents have to be believers, right? And this is disputed, continues. We've already discussed this numerous times before, so I won't go over it again and bore anyone. But this is an ongoing dispute that exists because there's a difference of opinion on the matter. But this is one of the ayat that's being used. Ibn al-Jawzi, you can see from what he said that he obviously holds the other end of the position, right? So that's something that you can look at. Now, the situation of Nabiyuna Ibrahim alayhi salam and his descendants, it brings up a very good point. So you understand, even at his time, people had questions. They say, well, listen, the time that this dua, the time that Nabiyuna Ibrahim alayhi salam is making this dua, is before the Kaaba has been rebuilt on its foundations. So how could he be making dua where it says here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it says here that, Lord, indeed I've caused my descendants to live near to me in a valley without vegetation in the sight of your sacred house. At the sight of your sacred house, how can it be at the sight of your sacred house when it hasn't been built up yet? Because the house was taken up in the flood. When the flood of Nabiyyina Nuh alayhi salam came, it devastated everything else, took the house. The house was taken up. So the Kaaba had not yet been rebuilt. You see, the Kaaba has been rebuilt several times. So it hadn't yet been rebuilt. So how is he making dua for a place that is not there regarding a situation that has not occurred yet? Because we've already read in Surah Al-Baqarah, Nabiyyina Ibrahim alayhi salam makes the dua when he's raising the foundations of the Kaaba. Now this dua is coming before that time. Historically, it's coming before that time. So what does this mean then? So Ibn al-Jawzi says the answer to your question is on three points. Number one, it's the spot where the sacred house was built has been sacred since the creation of the skies and the earth. So when he says, in the sight of your sacred house, inda, if he'd said fi, that would have been a mistake. But it says inda, meaning at that site. If he said fi, it would have mean literally that place itself. But it says inda, which means at that site. But that's part of the brilliance of Imam Joseph rahimahullah thinking about these things. Because people have these contradictory thoughts, and it's not that people don't believe, they're asking genuine, honest questions. And we have to answer these questions. We can't say to people when they ask this type of question that you shouldn't do that, don't stuff it in law, don't mention these questions, don't ask these questions. Because it may not be that they have any doubts, it may be that someone else has come to them with this. Or it may be that the qadeen that's sitting next to them has started whispering, and it's caused them some difficulty. So Imam al-Jawzi rahimahullah, his first answer is that the spot is sacred. So it says inda. Number two, it's talking about the spot before the house was raised, before the flood. So the spot where the Kaaba is now, it has always been in that spot. If you get a chance to ever look, when I went on Hajj, I got a chance to look. You go under, look past the brickwork under there, past that green brickwork, which is limestone and everything else. When you look at the base, the bottom, you can see it's firmly anchored and rooted. It's firmly anchored and rooted in the earth. That is granite or some type of hard red hewn stone. It's firmly rooted. There's no way you could lift it out of its place. It's been firmly rooted there. I'd be very interested just from the geological standpoint to know if it's even moved a quarter of an inch from its place, because I doubt it has. It's been there that long. It has no signs of movement. Normally when you have rock that settles and it shifts from its place, you get what's called disjunction. There's no disjunction there. It's sound. I'm not talking about the marble floor. I'm talking about the area, that actual foundational area. That area doesn't look like it's moved at all. I doubt it's even moved even a quarter of an inch. That's that place. Now, number three, the house which shall be built in that place. Because sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have to remember, when you look at Surah Al-A'raf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks in the past, present, and future tense about the Day of Judgment. He said, they went in. But they went in the fire. What do you mean went in? They're not even in there yet. The Day of Judgment hasn't even happened yet. But to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as far as he's concerned, past, present, and future are all one thing. Because what are they all? They're all creations, aren't they? So if they're creations, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bound by his creations? No, that's the first thing you learn in theology. That's major kufr. You have to say, no, that can't be. Why? Because laysa kamithlihi shay'un wa huwa as-sami'ul basir. Surah Al-Shura, 42nd Surah, Ayah 11. Right? So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not bound by any of his creations. Imam al-Tahawi rahimahullah says in his i'tiqad that he is not encompassed by the six directions. Up, down, side, back, front. Those six directions, they do not encompass Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when he says above, it means he's different to his creation. Above doesn't mean above like what you and I understand. We've already been through this. But I'm saying this to just jog it home and bring back, oh yes, that's right. So sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions future events to prophetically mention to his prophets or the people that are going to hear of it so that they remember what is to come. And in this particular case, you have Nabiyyina Ibrahim alayhi salam, the narration that he gives, because Abu Sulaiman al-Dimashqi, rahimahullah, big alim in Ibn al-Jawzi's time, He says that the outward form of this ayah is referring to the fact that the du'a must have been after the building of the Kaaba in Mecca was a land. But all the other scholars of commentary say that can't be the plan. That can't be the case. Because looking at the historicity of what's in these ayat and the information that's being given, that they're in a valley without any vegetation, with any water and everything else, and that he's bringing his descendants there, that has to be when Nabiyuna Ismail alayhi salam is still very small. Because the foundation stone of the Kaaba and everything else had the Kaaba built back on it after the circumcision of Nabiyuna Ismail alayhi salam, which was when? When he was 13. So if he's saying my baniya and he's bringing his children there and he's setting them there, that must mean what? It's before he's 13, which means it's before the foundation stones, which were laid, which means it can't be at the time that Imam Abu Sulaiman Damascus is referring to. But notice how much respect he shows to his sheikh. He doesn't say, he's on falsehood. No, he didn't say that. He said, but all the scholars of commentary have said the opposite of what the sheikh is saying. He didn't just come out and say, he's become kafir. No, he said, but the scholars, they say the opposite. Right? Sometimes the ulama, they say, وَمَا يَبْلَغَهُ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ. It may be that maybe this hadith didn't reach him. That's what they say about the ulama. They don't say, oh, he's wrong. He doesn't know what is in the sunnah. They say, no. لَا يَبْلَغَهُ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ. Maybe this hadith didn't reach him. Or maybe he meant something else. وَعَلَى هَذَا مَعَنَ آخر. Maybe it's a different meaning what he meant. Maybe he understood it slightly different. So, this statement then, Nabiyullah Ibrahim alayhi salam, he leaves out of Sham. He has baby Ismail, the mother of Ismail, Hajar alayhi salam, the angel Jibreel alayhi salam, they come to the place where Mecca was going to be. And there were some people that were living around that area. Right? There's some people living around that area. So the city limits of Mecca was already still established. People living there in that area called the Amalik, or the Amaliq, which I think in English they say Amalekites. I'm not sure. The Amaliq, I think it's Amalekites, outside of Mecca city limits. And the house at that point, this is the Kaaba, at that point was hewn red stones. Right? So it hadn't been the foundation, you could see the side of it, but it was just the hewn red stones. And that's where he said, have I been ordered to put my family here? So when he sets them there, that's inside the city limits of Mecca. That's where the Kaaba is going to be built back up. That's when all this stuff is going to happen. So that's 4,000 years of history that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just gave us a history lesson. 4,000 years and said, here, take this page, take these 15 lines, there's 4,000 years for you. So we have to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He makes promises to certain people covenantally, those promises, they stay firm, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps His word, right? Now, inshallah, I will carry on from here. And inshallah, we'll probably wind up finishing the last page of this surah, inshallah. Now, the Imam Rahimullah then says, quote, when the Exalted One says, our Lord, so that the prayer might be established, meaning that the prayer is established and it protects him and his children from the worship of idols. So by keeping them away from idols, what keeps one away from idols except for establishing the prayer? This is the statement of Muqatil. And that his descendants should stay and live in the house, in the side of the house, to establish the prayer. Because the ancient house is the Qibla for all the prayers, as has been mentioned by Imam al-Mawardi. And that it's made a place of feeling for the people, that they feel for it. Meaning that it is firmly placed and loved in the hearts of a jama'ah of humanity. Because they feel love for that place. And their hearts are attuned to it. Lord, you know what we conceal. Ibn Abbas said, what we conceal, meaning that he felt sadness that he had to take Ismail out of his household. And he had great love for him. So the scholars of commentary also say he only said this because when he set Ismail down in front of the Haram sanctuary, he knew that he had to leave him. But right after this, He praises Allah by saying, praise be to Allah who bestowed on me in my old age Ismail and Ishaq. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu has said, Ismail was born to him while he was 99 years old. And Ishaq was born to him when he was 112 years old. Now, when you look at the ayah, according to the recitation of many of the authorities, it's Rabbana wa taqabbal du'a'i. However, this is the recitation of Ibn Kathir, Abu Amr, Hamza, Hubayra, from Hafs, from Asim. But for the others, it's وَتَقَبَّلْ دُعَى. Now when he says, our Lord, forgive me and my parents. Ibn al-Anbari said he sought forgiveness for his parents while they were alive, for he wanted them to be guided to Islam. But it's also been said that forgiveness for his parents meant that forgiveness for Nabiyuna Adam wa Hawa alayhim as-salam out of love for them. Not for forgiveness, but out of love. The recitation of Ibn Mas'ud and Ubayy ibn Ka'b and Ibrahim al-Nakhai and Az-Zuhri was Wali Waladayya. So Waladayya rather than Walidayya would be referring to Ismail and Ishaq. But this is a narration that is rare among the people. Al-Mujahid said, Wali walidi, and my parents, meaning on Tawheed. And Asim al-Juhdi is recited, Wali wuldi. While it's been recited by Yahya ibn Ya'mar and Joni as Wali waladi. It is a reference to Allah's Tawheed. On the day that the people shall stand for the accounting, meaning they shall be rewarded for their deeds, and the people shall be standing. And people know when they hear the word Yomul Hisab, that is sufficient to make them understand that that is the day of judgment. And do not think for a moment that Allah is unmindful regarding what the oppressors do. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said, this is a warning for every oppressor. And it's also a glad tiding for the one who is oppressed, because he knows that safety is coming. Indeed, he, Allah, only delays them, meaning delays the oppression of the oppressors and delays the oppressors to the time of their appointment, to a day in which the eyes shall roll back in the head. The eyes will roll back in the head out of terror because of what they shall see. Exalted One then says further, مهطعين مقنعي رؤوسهم لا يرتد إليهم طرفهم وأفئدتهم هواء وأنذر الناس يوم يأتيهم العذاب فيقول الذين ظلموا ربنا أخرنا إلى أجل قريب نجب دعوتك ونتبع الرسل أولم تكونوا أقسمتم من قبل ما لكم من زوال وسكنتم في مساكن الذين ظلموا أنفسهم وتبين لكم كيف فعلنا بهم
كَيْفَ فَعَلْنَا بِهِمْ وَضَرَبَنَا لَكُمُ الْأَمْثَالِ وَقَدْ مَكَرُوا مَكْرَهُمْ وَعِنْدَ اللَّهِ مَكْرُهُمْ وَإِنْ كَانَ مَكْرُهُمْ لِتَزُولَ مِنْهُ الْجِبَالِ فَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ اللَّهَ مُخْلِفَ وَعْدِهِ رُسُلَهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ ذُو انْتِقَامٍ يَوْمَ تُبَدَّلُ الْأَرْضُ غَيْرَ الْأَرْضِ وَالسَّمَاوَاتِ وَبَرَزُوا لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدِ الْقَهَّارِ وَتَرَى الْمُجْرِمِينَ يَوْمَئِذٍ مُقَرَّنِينَ فِي الْأَصْفَادِ سَرَابِيلُهُمْ مِنْ قَطِرَانٍ وَتَغْشَى وُجُوهَهُمُ النَّارُ لِيَجْزِيَ اللَّهُ كُلَّ نَفْسٍ مَا كَسَبَتْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ سَرِيعُ الْحِسَابِ هذا بلاغ للناس ولينذروا به وليعلموا أنما هو إله واحد وليذكروا أولو الألباب.
They will be rushing forward, their heads agape, and their senses shall not return to them. Their hearts shall be poured open all over the place. People shall take heed and warning on the day that there shall come to them the punishment. Those who were oppressors shall say, Our Lord, give us delay for a near time. We will answer your call. We will follow the messengers. Were you not swearing from before that you would never accept this and that your life would be forever? Did you not live in your habitations in which you oppressed yourselves? And it was made clear to you how we had done with them, and we gave examples for you to know what was the end of the wicked oppressors. They had plotted and made their plans, and indeed Allah knew and had with him their plans. And even their plans were so great so as to move the very mountains from their places. Do not be unmindful and think for one moment that Allah broke his promise or breaks his promise to his messengers. Indeed, Allah is mighty and the one who brings the vengeance. On the day that the earth will be changed to another earth and another skies, they shall come forward to Allah, the one, the dominant. You will see the criminals on that day moving forward in rows, to and fro, overturned, clothes cut for them from the fire, and their faces dipping headlong into it. Every soul will be rewarded by Allah for what it earned. Indeed, Allah is quick in taking account. This is the clear news and propagation to the human race, so that they might take heed of Him, and so that they might know that there's only one God, and so that those who might take heed indeed do take heed. Surah Ibrahim, the 15th surah, ayat 43 to 52. When the Exalted One is mentioned that they are rushing forward, it means they're looking without being able to fix their gaze because they're in terror. This is mentioned by Ibn Abbas, Mujahid, Abdahaq, and Abu Buha. Secondly, it's happening so quickly that they're terrified. This has been mentioned by Al-Hasan al-Basri, Sa'id ibn Jubayr, and Qatada and Abu Ubaidah. So it is similar, as Ibn Qutayba has said, is when a camel is being called along the way, that when it's called suddenly and it's thirsty or hungry, it bolts forward, its neck dangling and jiggling as it runs, seeking some form of sustenance from its master. But in this case, those bolting forward We go bolting forward to the fire, as mentioned by the Fatim. Also, their eyes will be fixed and staring forward in horror. But Ibn Zayd has said that they won't be able to lift their heads once they've been dipped in the fire. And once they're brought into the fire, Ibn Abbas has said they will dash their heads up, but they will be brought back down, as Mujahid, Sa'id ibn Jubayr, Qatada, Abu Ubaid, and others have mentioned. So what's coming to them shall overwhelm them, and they will be thrown about, and their senses shall not return to them. And their feelings will be thrown, and their chests will be split open, and their hearts be exposed. As the expression is made and said by Ibn Abbas, that their hearts leap up in their throats. There's no good in something like this happening to you. This is the certain destruction. There's no escape from this at all. Devastation is certain. When someone's heart is laid bare and they're in terror, their intellect leaves them. And they seek nothing but safety. They're told, Allah says that the people have been warned of a day that shall come, where the punishment shall come on the day of judgment. And he mentions the punishment. And by mentioning the punishment, he's also inadvertently mentioning the reward. Because the punishment is for the rejected and disobedient ones. And he says that those who oppress, meaning they oppress themselves through idolatry, they will ask, O Allah, delay us to a period of time. Give us a small bit of time, we will change. So they're asking to return back to their earthly life, because they feel that their exit from the earthly life was too soon, it was too quick, and that they will answer the call of Tawheed. But it will be said to them, weren't you those who swore your strongest oaths that this life you would never be resurrected? That you would forever be here, and that once you were dead, and you would not go to the hereafter? You went down in your homes, lived your lives, and then you went down in your graves after oppressing yourselves due to your unbelief and disobedience. And it was made clear to you the truth. Now the recitation, وَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمْ. This recitation is mentioned by Abu Abdur-Rahman al-Sulami and Abu al-Mutawakkil al-Naji. وَتُبُيِّنَ. But the rest of the authorities say, وَتَبَيَّنَ. So Allah mentions here how he punished them. And it's necessary that you avoid this punishment. And Allah gives his signs. So Allah, by these signs, Ibn Abbas has said, Allah is giving many signs in the Quran. Allah says that they made their plan. Now this ayah is referring to a number of things, one of which is the plan that Nimrud made to try to murder Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam regarding his Lord. When he built the lofty tower, and brought forward his tower, the greatest in its time. And built this tower as high as Allah had willed it. And when it was brought up to the highest point, he went up and said, look, what do you see? And the man said, I see the earth, but it's covered in clouds as if smoke. He says, that's right. Then he went up further flights in this large structure. And he said, now look. And he said, I can't see anything except for the sky. And so he became arrogant because of the structure that he had built. because it was so large it was overlooking the mountains. And this is the way that Nimrud attempted or tried to overwhelm the senses of Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam. Because the building that he made was so large that by standing on it, one could see the waters below, and one was near clouds. So huge was this building. The building was made out of red mud brick and other materials. It was known as a Nasur. And Allah allowed him to make this structure, take the assistance to make use of this so that his plan might be shown. And people near the end of time shall see the same thing, as we've already been told in prophecy, when these massive buildings appear again that try to dwarf the sky, or where these massive buildings cover one side of the mountains. You will know at that time that the hour is near, so I already warned you. Because their plans are so great as to move the mountains from their places. Part of this means to build buildings so large that they rival the mountains. This was done by Nimrud. This was also done by people such as Darius and Nebuchadnezzar. So this is not the first time this has been done. This is the truth. These are referring to the nations of old who carried these things out. It's also referring to the fact that nations of old always make plans about what they shall do. But Allah knows their plans. He has their plans right in front of them. So when people made their plans against the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to kill him or to expel him, Allah had their plan right in front of him. And He, Allah, preserved him from their wickedness. And He, Allah, shall reward them for their plans. Indeed, their plans were such that they would try to move the mountains from their places, Allah has said. So their plans, Allah says at one point that they're weak. But likewise, their plans are all-encompassing and large. Because their plans are so wicked and devious and evil. So we're talking about the well-known mountains, not a metaphor. Their plans are so great so as to move mountains from their places, because some of them have and will do this. It's also a metaphor because the deen of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was established, just like the establishment of the mountains, the high mountains. So their plans will even try to disallow his religion, just as one would try to overwhelm the mountains. But Allah has said, as Ibn Zajjaj has given his commentary, do not be unmindful and think that Allah breaks his promise to his prophet, to his messengers, meaning that they will be victorious, that their religion will be victorious. And he intends by his promise their his help, his victory, the manifestation of the faith. And Allah is mighty and shall show vengeance to the unbelievers. And their reward is great punishment because of their kufr. When Allah says on the day that He shall replace the earth with another earth, it means that that earth will be turned into something different, will be taken away, and something new shall be set in its place. At first, the earth that we live on will be flattened and spread out, and it will be changed to other than the earth that we know, which is mentioned by Imam al-Tabarani in a hadith from Rasul alayhi salatu wassalam. It will also be changed to other than itself. It will be changed to another earth. The other earth will be bright like silver. No sins will ever have been done on it. As has been mentioned by Ibn Mas'ud, Atta, Ibn Abbas, and Mujahid. And the earth that was before shall be as fire and flame. This was mentioned by Ubay ibn Ka'b. The earth, the new earth being of silver and having a ground of silver, pure and plain, and where the believers shall be sufficed from all the food that they need, of bread or whatever the matter shall be.
as discussed by Abu Huraira, Sa'id ibn Jubayr, Qurdi, and all the believers of Islam will be able to take whatever their needs are. The sky shall be changed to another sky, meaning that it shall first go away the sky that we know, all the skies that we know. And nothing is left but the skies of that will be coming for the paradise, under which rivers flow. The sun will be folded up and put away. The stars shall be scattered, as mentioned by Ibn Abbas in commentary on this and other ayat. Their form shall be changed. They shall pass away. They shall brighten violently and then pass away as nothing, as mentioned by Ibn Abbas. The sky will be rolled away and rolled up just like one scroll, just like one folds up the scroll of a book. And there is nothing that anyone can do about that. Close quote. Very quickly, Imam al-Jawzi rahimahullah, in this ayah, the discussion where he talks about the stars becoming suddenly and violently bright and then dimming and losing altogether. If you've ever had the chance to look at a supernova or the collapse of a star, this is pretty much the gist of what he's discussing, the end of these things. And you could look at in Surah al-Mursalat, 77th Surah, فَإِذَا النُّجُومُ طُمِسَتْ, when the stars are blotted out. That ayah is number one referring to the fact that there were buildings in ancient times that had lights put on it that were so bright that you could not see the night sky, which is the same thing that's being done now. So these are things that aren't unusual. Nimrud building that massive tower where you can only see the oceans and other things. Go look at the other towers that are in the Middle East. Go look at the Empire State Building. Go look at the Sears Towers. This is what comes from all wicked and oppressive nations. First thing, they build themselves up and exalt themselves over their Lord. Now we have the final portion for tonight, inshallah. The Imam rahimahullah, he says, quote, those who have died will be brought forward to Allah, the One, the Dominant. The meaning, they shall be brought forward from their graves. You will see the criminals, meaning the unbelievers, hastening forward with the shayateen that were with them. Their hands and feet shall be moving quickly as they walk. They shall be bound and chained. All of this was mentioned by Ibn Abbas, Ibn Qutayba, Ibn Zayd, Abu Ubaidah, Ibn Qutayba, Al-Zajjaj, Al-Ambadi, Ibn Al-Ambadi, Abu Suleiman al-Damashqi. And their clothes shall be cut from the fire. So for their hereafter, their clothes are cut of fire. They shall be given to them as the end result of their lives. Now Allah the Exalted, they shall be burned for all eternity according to His will and according to His proof. He had already warned them of its reality. And this is the same thing that was mentioned by Ibn Abbas, Abu Razin, Abu Majlis, Ikrimah, Qatada, Ibn Abi Ablah, Abu Hatim, narrating from Yaqub, and mentioned the ayah as min qitrin. But others have also given it the extra tanween from the other narrators. And the faces shall be thrown headlong into the fire, and Allah shall certainly reward them for what they used to do. He, Allah, then said, this is a propagation to the human race. The propagation, the balal, is another word for the Quran and the warnings. And this warning is sufficient, as mentioned by Muqatil. And although the people of Mecca were specifically brought this message initially, it's for all of humanity, so that people might take heed and be warned, meaning that which was sent down, they might take warning. They might act by what is in it from the proofs and know that He, Allah, is only one God. So they might remember and take heed, because those that take heed will remember this admonition. Close quote. So we have completed Surah Ibrahim,
today, alhamdulillah. So we are on the road to Surah Al-Hijr, inshallah, which is the 15th surah. That's a Meccan surah that will be coming, all right? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the ability to complete this. So inshallah, next week we start Surah Al-Hijr. Are there questions over what we've covered so far today? Yes.
We have the measurements of the tower of building.
The measurements, unfortunately, I have not seen any listing for the measurements. But it will give you an idea of how large it is. I mean, if you look at the fact, if you want to think of how large it is, where you can see the waters down below and there's clouds near it, the previous twin towers were that large. In fact, they were so large they had to have stabilizers on top of them, which were massive. They had mercury, big mercury pan containers inside of them to keep it stable. So when the wind was very strong, they would sway slightly. They had to be built. So this is something comparable to that. Because if you get a chance in your spare time, you can also look up one of the great seven. There's what's called the seven wonders of the world. And one of the wonders of the world was the Colossus of Rhodes. Now, the Colossus of Rhodes was supposed to be this gigantic statue built to welcome people into the city of this idol of Rhodes. And it was so huge that people could see it from outside when they were coming in from the ocean into the harbor, which would mean that it would have to be more than 50, 60 stories. And that's the ancient world. It was made out of bronze. And when they were finally conquered and the Colossus of Rhodes was snatched, they said it took months to melt it down. Months. So that makes you understand it was huge. We tend to think now that the things now are big, but there were things that were gigantic back then. Huh? Questions? It's just as if it didn't work. All right. Further questions from the brothers? We're waiting for some. Yes.
Do you know, or do you have any information about how they went about building these huge towers?
All right, the question is, do we have the information about how they went about building these massive towers? The unfortunate thing about it is, you have to remember, which is the opposite of how we understand material sciences today. Material sciences, as they're taught today, is that we were living in caves and wearing pelts made out of animal skin, and then we gradually became more advanced. But that's not what the historical record lends us. Historical record shows us that the Great Pyramid in Giza was built using the golden mean from what was in their head. They didn't use paper. It shows us that the oldest city in the world, Tetuan, one of the bricks for that building is 212,000 tons. Now, there's no machinery on earth that we have that's capable of moving these stones. We've had to figure out and say, okay, well, how do we know how much they weigh? Because we've measured the stones across and looked at their weight and how much the stone would weigh, and we're able to figure out, no, it weighs roughly 212,000 tons. Not pounds, 212,000 tons, T-O-N-N-E-S. The city is no longer inhabited. Now, this is one of the examples where, unfortunately, we do not know many times how they've gone about building these cities. We just have remnants that are left over. The Colossus of Rhodes, unfortunately, we don't have remnants. Nebuchadnezzar's massive building with the Ziggurats, we do have examples of that building. And we have references to it in other pieces of historical literature, because people tried to say that the Colossus of Rhodes or Nimrod's Tower, that those are, they're just historical legends. But there's that many people mentioning them that are coming from different places that don't share any, they don't share any benefit with admitting that it was there. Just as much as someone said, if I said that the two twin towers that were 185 stories each, the North and South Tower, that's just American folklore, just like George Washington and Thomas Jefferson existed, right? If I said that, but people were able to produce Japanese people that had been there, English people that had been there, and other people that have no particular, they have no reason to fabricate anything about them, then it becomes an established empirical fact because we can't deny it. What we do know is that that structure was made out of red mud brick and limestone. And obviously, we can still see today, the Great Pyramid was built, 5,000 years ago, and it's still there.
So it's made out of much stronger fiber and stone and mortar than what's being used for houses today. I mean, what's the shelf life for a house today with the mortar that we've got? 30 years, 40 years, even Edwardian houses. People are really impressed. When the United Kingdom, they thought, oh, this house is Edwardian. They're really impressed with that. So you go to Giza, you drive out there, you see the Great Pyramid. It's 5,000 years old. It's moved about an inch its foundation's moved an inch in 5,000 years. The pigments that they use to paint the images of the pharaohs and everything, they've not faded. They don't even know what compounds they use to mix the colors that they made to paint the images. But they've not been affected by oxidation. And those are Kafirs. Can you imagine what the Muslims are? Those are pagans that did that. They worship idols. They believe the cat had divine powers. They used to mummify them and put them in the graves next to them. Imagine what the Muslims were like if these are the pagans. So, unfortunately, we don't have a lot of details, but what we can say is they were using the materials around them. Now, how they went about mixing those materials, what type of mortar they used, we don't have all the permutations on that or all the details on that, unfortunately. But we can only sort of guess, and that's what scientists are trying to do. They're trying to extrapolate and guess. How did they get the stones to the Great Pyramid? How did they do it? How large it must have been, the building, Nimrod's tower, how do they build it? It couldn't have been that big. It must have been more wide than tall. No, people are talking about going up the building and looking down and seeing clouds. That's massive. Okay, so it must have been something. It had to be around the 180, 100 story mark, because that's where you start seeing clouds and the ocean, and you can start seeing cities around you. Right? Questions? Further questions? Yes? No, thank you. Further questions? No? Any questions from sisters? No? Okay. So if that is there, we will stop here, inshallah. We will reconvene next week. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdika. Wa ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Innahu ghafurur rahim. Ya arhamar rahimin. Wa la ilaha illa Allah. Wassalamu alaikum.